Good morning. It's so good to see y'all this morning. Hosanna. Let's praise Hosanna this morning. Let's stand up. Praise is rising. Sing with us.
Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Good morning. It's a lot different morning than a week ago. Absolutely. If you're visiting with us today, you are our honored guest, and we're so proud to have you. We'd like to have a record of your attendance. If you take your bulletin and tear this tab off, complete this side, and drop it in the offering plate when it goes around, we'd really appreciate it. Did y'all know April is National Frog Month? Y'all didn't know that? Did you know that?
Well, I didn't know that, but speaking of National Frog Month, did I tell you about my friend Kermit Jagger?
Kermit, like as in Mick Jagger, Rolling Stone?
You've met him a few times.
Oh, wait. Oh, yeah, he was real hoppy.
He was real hoppy. Well, Kermit, y'all, this is a good one now. We've been practicing this all week, okay? All right. Well, Kermit went on up to Farmers and Merchants Bank in Lafayette, Alabama, the best bank, okay? Let me hear you. Yeah. All right, okay? He went on up there to Farmers and Merchants because he wanted a loan for $50,000 to go on vacation. So he went to see the loan officer, Mrs. Patricia Whack, and Mrs. Patricia Whack said, "Well, Mr. Kermit Jagger, I don't have a problem giving you this loan if you have some collateral." So he reached in his little froggy pocket and pulled out a little porcelain statue that kind of looked like an elephant and kind of didn't look like an elephant. And she said, "Well, Stanley is very wise. And so let me go talk to Stanley and see if this collateral is going to make it or not, okay? All right, you know Stanley's good. He's good to us. Yeah. He's good to everybody, okay?
Yeah.
All right, so Miss Patricia Whack took the little elephant sort of statue in there to see Stanley, and she said, "Stanley, Mr. Jagger, Kermit Jagger, wants $50,000 for a loan to go on vacation, and this is all he has for collateral." And Stanley, in his wise words, said, "It's a knick-knack, Patty Whack. Give the frog a loan. His old dad is a Rolling Stone."
She tells everybody she knows that joke. All right, today is Centra Kids lunch and Easter egg hunt. Just a reminder, there's no charge to eat today, but they sure would appreciate a donation. When you're heading over to the Family Life Center, instead of forming a line like we normally do when we eat, if you'll just go ahead and be seated, the campers are looking forward to serving you today. That's right. Also, if you brought Easter eggs for the Easter egg hunt, if you will take them to that back hallway and just line them up along through there, then Miss Mindy can organize those. Or if you have some, Mindy will take them from you. Or anybody will take them over there if you need us to. Children through the sixth grade are invited to participate in the hunt. Next week is the last Sunday to order our Bible school t-shirts, and that is also on this tab. So if you just complete that, and you can drop that in the offering plate, or if you want to turn it into the office, that's fine also. Holy Week services begin tomorrow at First Baptist at noon, and they will continue through Friday, Good Friday. Our day to serve on that is Tuesday. And they only have about half the amount of soup that we need to serve everyone. So if you could please sign up for some soup, that would be great. We don't want to make Lafayette Heights look bad in front of the whole town. So, all right. College and career class, 100% today. So. We had 94 people present for Sunday school, so that's a big number. We're excited about that. Yeah. Oh, yeah, there were three people in the men's class. They're 100%. Thank you, Charles. Okay, April 16th is the youth barbecue lunch. See, you can get your tickets from the youth, and they're $10 a ticket. Now, this is one of our meals that we really need a good head count because they have to prepare enough barbecue for that. So if y'all, you really need a ticket to eat at that one. But any of the youth have tickets. I think Jeannie has tickets. Gotcha. Jeannie has extra tickets if anybody needs extra tickets. Okay. For anybody listening on YouTube, we've learned you really can't hear what goes on unless it's through this microphone. Their deposits are due today. Is that what you said? Okay. All right. There's a summer family night planning meeting at the Family Life Center. It will be Monday, April 24th at 6 p.m. Brunching for babies. This is something new, I think, that the ladies are doing. All ladies are invited to a brunch on Saturday, April 15th at 10 a.m. in the Family Life Center. There will be a speaker from Save-A-Life present, and you'll sign up for that in the vestibule. There's some more notes. I think they want you to bring
something to eat.
Yeah, bring something to eat for brunch and a gift item. I'm sure y'all will have a good time eating and talking together. We're still collecting for the Annie Armstrong offering, so just remember that. And Miss Sherry has an announcement. She wants to a project that she's heading up, so we just need more information about this. Okay. Thank you for heading that up, Sherry. And yes. Okay. Gotcha. Okay. So Coffee in the Community is still on. And Sherry has provided prayer cards for all grandparents. This is going to be a great program that Sherry is heading up. They'll be back on the table in the vestibule. Is where you're going to put those? Okay. All right. Great. Thanks. Oh, yes. Well, something important. There may have been some miscommunication in the email. We are having services tonight. But we're not having services next Sunday night or Eastern evening night. So we are having services tonight, but not next Sunday night. Flowers today are placed by Miss Ramona in memory of Mr. Roger, and they are certainly beautiful. And we thank you for that. We certainly do miss Mr. Roger, but we appreciate you putting those here in his memory. Okay, prayer list. Elizabeth Talley has COVID. We need to remember Steve Fields. He's still not where he can come back to church. Also, Jan and Joe, just keep them in your prayers. And are there any others that we need to add? All right, well, if not, let's pray for these. Dearly Father, Lord, what a beautiful day to come into your house, Lord, to worship you. Lord, I'm so grateful that you give us this privilege, Lord, and just for the privilege of speaking with you directly, Lord, and knowing that you hear us whenever we call out to you, Lord. We praise you for that. Lord, I bring these prayer requests to you this morning for Elizabeth, for her COVID infection. Lord, I just pray for quick healing, Lord, that you would just keep her, reduce her symptoms, and help her to get well really fast. Lord, for Steve, I just pray that you would just be an extra blessing to him, Lord, today and this week, Lord. just help him to get back to church where I know he wants to be, Lord. I just pray that you would continue to heal him. And Lord, also for Jan and Joe, Lord, just, you know, their needs, Lord, their ongoing needs. And, you know, it's not something that's going to happen right away, Lord, that we know this is going to be a long time. But Lord, we bring all of those requests to you, Lord, and we just pray that you would be with them and just every situation in their life that they're facing, Lord. I just pray that you might address those and just take care of them, Lord. And Lord, thank you for our Century Kids campers, Lord. Thank you for the lunch today, Lord. Lord, I just go ahead and pray for blessing on that food, that you might bless it to the nourishments of our bodies and our bodies to your service, Lord. And Lord, just forgive us when we fail you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Yes.
We have a men's breakfast on the 30th.
Okay. Okay, men's breakfast, April 30th.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what time? 8, 7? 8
o'clock.
8 o'clock, okay. All right, and I wanted to just give you all another update on our pastor search committee. We are still in the process of collecting resumes. We've got a lot of those to look over. Everybody on the committee got a folder about this thick this morning to study and to pray over and to do research on. So y'all just be in prayer for that. When the man, his name was Ken Allen from the State Board of Missions, he met with us at our initial meeting. Something that he stressed to us was that if we fail to pray, then we have failed. So the committee thought that we needed an emphasis placed on prayer and the church praying over this whole process. So can y'all come help us pass these out right here, Mr. Lanny? Stephen, yeah. Rhonda, where's Rhonda? Oh, okay. Yeah, you can. That'd be fine. We've got these bracelets, you know, that are so popular nowadays for whatever you stand for, whatever. We've got the bracelets that say, if you fail to pray, you fail. And then on the other side, it says, pray LHBC. So if you all would just grab one of those, and if you want to wear it, then that's great. If you don't, just set it somewhere you can see it, you know, throughout the day. But we just we thought that would be a great way to get the whole church involved. Something I wanted to read this to you. 1 John 5:14 says, this is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask for anything according to his will, he hears us. Also, in the morning, Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you and wait expectantly. That's Psalms 5:3. You can have these, you can put them on, you know, two different ways, but I like to wear mine so that I can read it, you know, it's not upside down. So, you know, just be in prayer about that, because we've got a lot of important decisions to make in the upcoming weeks with our resumes and the direction our church will go. So I just appreciate that. And they'll be available in the office if somebody didn't get one, if you're listening through YouTube. We'll have those available for anyone who wants one. So, are you out?
I ordered mine.
Does anybody else need one? And if you know somebody who's not here, you can grab one for them. Hey, Stephen, will you dump the extras in that bag so we can have the plates for offering? All right, thank y'all.
All right, you can remain seated, but sing with us, praise him, praise him. Praise him, praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Sing all earth his wonderful love proclaim.
I'm so glad to see all of y'all today. Oh, some of you are visiting with us, and we're glad to have you. I want to talk to you for just a minute about making a list. Do y'all know anything that we make a list for? What kind of things would we make a list for?
Bucket trucks.
Okay.
We make a list for people.
We do. We make a prayer list on Wednesday night. That's good.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right. That's right. Santa makes a list. That's right. Naughty and nice. Do any of your parents make a grocery list? Stuff they're going to buy at the grocery store? Yeah. We got, Miss Kim says, yeah. We make grocery lists. Oh, let me tell you what goes on at my house every Christmas. My grandkids have gotten so old, I ask for a list of things they want for Christmas because I don't even know what you buy people anymore. So we make a Christmas list. Oh, you know what? In school, your teacher has a roll of everybody in that class. That's a list of students. Our church has a list of people. We have a list of everybody who's a member at Lafayette Heights Baptist Church. It's called our church roll. Put that down, please. Okay. That's right. We have a list of things that we're going to do when we go on vacation. You know, we'll say we're going to do this on Monday, this on Tuesday, this on Wednesday. So you know what? We make lists a lot of times.
We make a list for Lucas.
We do. And now listen to Miss Donna. This is the important part. God has a list. Do you know that God has made a list?
Yeah.
Look, let me tell you what it is. God has a book called the Lamb's Book of Life. And the only people who can get into heaven are the people whose names are in the Lamb's Book of Life. At the moment that you repent of your sin and you give your life to Jesus, He writes your name in the Lamb's Book of Life, and nobody can ever erase your name. So boys and girls, I want you to know something. We're talking about all these lists we make, but this is the most important list of all. And I hope and I pray that everybody sitting up here today will make sure that your name is on that list. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your Son Jesus who died to save us for our sin. Thank you that when you write our names in your book, it can never be erased. We are yours for all of eternity. Help us to live for you each day of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Now listen, go out here and sit down for just a minute because we want to watch the hallelujah hands. So right here behind Miss Donna, let's just line up on this pew and then we'll go to class. Y'all come with me.
All right, everybody, please stand. Let's sing together. Oh, praise the name.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior on that cursed Oh, praise.
have such a special treat for our... Oh, yeah, y'all going down. We have such a special treat for our special music this morning. We have the Hallelujah Hands group. So y'all be coming on up, little Hallelujah Hands.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see you all this morning.
Good to see our Hallelujah Hands up here this morning performing. I want to say a word of thank you to them. I want to say a word of thanks to all of those who worked hard on preparing the meal for today. They were here just a little bit after the break of dawn this morning making preparations, and so we're looking forward to a good dinner together today. Our text today comes from 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. And it's a powerful statement because literally every word in this verse is packed with meaning. And so we're going to break this verse down in three parts, and each part will be a basis for one of the 3 points of the message today. But I want us to begin by looking at the full passage, and then we will study it together. For Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive by the Spirit. You know, sometimes you don't have to say a lot to say a lot. And you would probably like for me to take my own advice sometimes, I'm sure. But in just a few words, you really can say something that will stand the test of time, something that will be remembered for generations. And I want to give you some examples this morning. Here's one. Ask what you can do for your country. Ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. President Kennedy, probably the most famous one-liner that was ever given in a presidential inaugural address. Here's another one. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Franklin Roosevelt. That helped us get through World War II. Abraham Lincoln said this. He said, "This nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from this earth." And maybe the greatest single speech any president ever gave, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall." President Reagan. President Reagan's remarks changed the Cold War, and just a few words, you'd kind of think those things would just stick in your mind, and they have. Many, many decades later, we still recall his challenge. In just a few words, we can say something that's really memorable, something that you won't forget, something that you'll bring up over and over again. And we learn that it's not the quantity of what you say that counts, it's the quality of what you say that counts. And so that's true today in this passage of Scripture that we're looking at this morning. We're in a series. We've been trying to answer the question, why Jesus? And we've talked about last week that there are over 4,000 religions in the world today. Why is Christianity the one way, the only way to God? Why do we as Christians believe that Christianity is the only faith that we should follow? Of all of the religious leaders who have ever lived, why do we say that Jesus is the only one that we should trust, the only one we should follow, the only one we should obey? Well, there are 3 things, as we talked about last week, and just recap them just for a moment today, 3 things that set Jesus apart, not just from every religious leader, but from every person who's ever lived: his life, his death, and his resurrection. Last week, we talked about how Jesus lived an unequaled life. He was the only person who ever claimed to be without sin, who never had anyone contradict him or convict him of sin. So today we're going to look at his death, because he died a unique death. Now, death in itself is not unique. There's a statistic that will never be broken, and that is that 1 out of every 1 persons die. We all leave this life through the door of death. Death is universal. It's inevitable. We know that that point is going to come at some point in the future. We don't know when, we don't know how, but we know that it's going to happen at some point. Medicine can't prevent it. Medicine can only postpone it. As a matter of fact, what we call living, we really ought to call dying, because the moment a baby is born, that moment he begins this process of dying. At that moment, cells begin this process of deteriorating and dying. Now, the truth of the matter is, at the end of someday, we will all be at the end of all of our days. So death in and of itself is not unique. You may ask, well, you said that Jesus died a unique death. What is it about the death of Jesus that is unique? Because even crucifixion was not unique. History tells us that there were some 30,000 Jews who were crucified outside of Jerusalem during the Roman reign. And so if Jesus is just one of those 30,000, what is it about his death that was unique? Well, what was unique about Jesus' death was, first of all, the reason that he died, and secondly, the result of his death. The reason that he died, why he died, and then the result of his death, what his death accomplished. So we're going to see in just one verse, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, we're going to see all that we need to know about what made Jesus' death unique. Remember that this passage is written by Peter. Peter was one of Jesus' disciples. He was a witness to the resurrection. He was with Jesus the night before he was crucified. So I think he kind of knows a little bit about what he's talking about here. In 1 Peter chapter 3, 18, we are answering the question, why should everybody look to Jesus to have a relationship with God? And why is Jesus the only one who can make that happen? Well, it's not just the way that he lived that tells us that he's the only one, but the way that he died helps us to answer that question. In 1 Peter chapter 1, in 1 Peter chapter 3, Peter says we ought to look to Jesus. And Jesus only, and Jesus alone, if we're going to have a relationship with God. There's one way to God, and that's through Jesus Christ. He said, I am the door. And so we must come through Christ. We must believe through Christ if we're going to have a relationship with God. We just can't walk into the presence of a king or a president and just immediately have access to him. If we were to go to a king and just say, hey, king, I want to talk with you. You know, we would be arrested. We would be hauled out of that place, because if we don't have credentials and we don't have an introduction, we don't have a means to get to that king, we don't have access. And the same thing is true to God. We just can't come into God's presence and tell God the terms on which we want to communicate with him. We have to come on his terms. And we have to have someone bring us into that relationship. And Jesus Christ is the only one who can bring us into a relationship with God. So I want us to look, first of all, this morning to Jesus as my permanent sacrifice. Remember, Peter was one of the 12 disciples. And not just one of the 12, he was one of the inner circle. There were three disciples, Peter, James, and John, who were closer to God than he was to Jesus. He had them together. More often, they were with him on the Mount of Transfiguration and at other times. And so they were part of the inner circle. But now Peter is taking us back to the cross, and he's telling us not just what happened physically, but he's telling us what happened spiritually. 1 Peter 3:18 says, for Christ died for sins once for all. He died for sins, and we'll see not just wasn't his sins, because he never sinned. But he died for sins. He died for our sins. He didn't die as a martyr. He didn't die as an example. He died as a sacrifice. Now, to be sure, crucifixion inflicted horrible physical suffering. But the real suffering that Jesus experienced was not the physical suffering. It was the spiritual suffering, because the Bible tells us that God laid on him the sins of all of us. Our sins were placed on Jesus, and when he died on the cross, he died as our sin bearer. He was carrying our sins in his body. And when he died for our sins. He became sin for us. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So Hebrews chapter 7 verse 27 is talking about Christ, our high priest. And it says that our high priest does not need daily, as those high priests, and he's talking about the Jewish high priest back in the days of Jesus' time on this earth. He does not need daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered it himself. The operative word in that verse is once. He suffered once. He died once. The Greek word that's used there is a unique word. It's a word that's only used in this verse in all of the Bible. It's the word hapax. And here's what it means. It means once and for all, never to be repeated again. And so that's the word that's being used there. One time for all time. Something that happened to this in this instance, on this occasion, is Jesus is crucified, but it's never to be repeated. Jesus does not die again and again and again. He died once, and so he's offered for our sins. He sacrificed for his sins. It was the first, it was the last, it was the final sacrifice, the only sacrifice that will ever need to be made. For the Jews who were accustomed to daily sacrifices in the temple, this was a breathtakingly new concept, because to atone for sin, the Jewish people had slaughtered millions of animals over a period of close to 2,000 years. It was endless. During Passover, every year it was like 250,000 lambs were offered as sacrifices in the Jewish temple. And so that was the pattern. That was what the Jewish people were accustomed to. But Jesus gave the sacrifice of all sacrifices. He sacrificed himself once and for all. And so when Jesus Christ paid the ultimate price, dying for our sins, all of those sacrificial lambs, that was the end of that. There was no need. Now, the Jews continued it, but God did not require it. He accepted the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, and that permanently took care of our sin problem. One of the last words that Jesus ever said on the cross was, "It is finished." And that word that Jesus spoke means it's paid in full. Everything's been taken care of. And so the Jewish priests were making sacrifices day after day. They never sat down. They never stopped. You know, the Bible gives us in detail a description of the temple, of the Holy of Holies, and it lists in that description all of the furniture that was in the Holy of Holies, all that was in the temple. There was no chair anywhere, not in the outer court, not the inner court, and certainly not in the Holy of Holies. There was no chair there. And so that Jewish priest was continually working. He was continually going through the process of making sacrifices on behalf of the people. And in that time, he never sat down. He never stopped. The author of Hebrews says this in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 12. But when this priest, and he's talking here about Jesus, when Jesus had offered for one time, for all time, one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. So now in the Jewish temple, there was no place to be seated. And so the Jewish high priest never sat down. But our high priest, Jesus Christ, when he had offered that one sacrifice for all time, he sat down at the right hand of God. You know, Jesus Christ paid for all of our sins. Some people have the idea that, well, he just made a down payment and we've got to continue making installment payments. We've got to continue to do things to maintain our salvation or to keep our salvation. Jesus paid for our sins once and for all, and it was a complete deal. When Jesus did that, he hung on the cross. He said, "It's finished. There's nothing more that you can do except to receive what I have done and what I'm doing for you," as he hung on that cross. So he didn't make a down payment for our sin, but once and for all time, he made the full payment for our sins. And so therefore, we look to Jesus as our permanent sacrifice. We don't have to make sacrifices anymore. Jesus Christ has paid the price. But not only our permanent sacrifice, but number two, I look to Jesus as my perfect substitute. Jesus died. He was not dying for himself. He died for you. He died for me. He died for anyone who ever lived or whoever will live. And this is the way Peter put it in verse 18. He says, "For Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous." So here we see the picture of an exchange taking place. We are unrighteous. Jesus Christ is righteous, and he's trading places with us. Jesus Christ is offering us his righteousness, and we give him his unrighteousness. He dies on the cross to pay for all of our unrighteousness. But Jesus Christ gives us his perfect righteousness. He's our perfect substitute. You maybe have never thought about it, but one of the reasons we ought to read the Bible is because we're in it. We actually are almost named in several places, and this is one of those places where he says the righteous for the unrighteous. You can take that word unrighteous and put your name in there, and it makes perfect sense, and it's a perfect description of what Christ has done for us. For Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for Paul Howard. He died for me. He died for me. He took my sins. Somehow through time and space, God allowed him, and God saw down through the ages, he saw every one of us. He saw every sin that we would ever commit, and somehow God took those sins and affixed them in the body of Jesus Christ. And when he died on the cross, he died bearing my sins. He died bearing your sins. And so all we need to do is we need to receive what Christ has done for us. We need to accept that and to believe that he did that for us. So on the cross, Jesus traded places for us. He died in our place. Let me tell you how this works. The reason we all die is because we're all sinners. What eventually kills all of us is not cancer, it's not aging, it's not heart disease, it's not diabetes. What eventually kills all of us is sin. When Adam and Eve were placed in the garden, they were there innocent. And it was not until they sinned that death came into the world. The Apostle Paul says the wages of sin is death. The prophet Ezekiel says, the soul that sinneth shall surely die. And so that's the pronouncement of God upon sin. So before Adam and Eve sinned, death was impossible. Death came into the world because of sin. And without sin, it would have never happened. Adam and Eve would have lived forever. But because of sin, death came. And death passed upon all men because we have all sinned. So Jesus died not for sins which he committed, but he died for our sins. He died in our place. He died as our substitute. Not just any substitute would do. It's got to be a perfect substitute. Jesus' righteousness was perfect righteousness. And so that's what we need. That's what we desire, is to be perfectly righteous, to stand before God one day without a sin to our name, our account clean, and in perfect righteousness. When Jesus died on the cross, one of the things that happened as he was on Golgotha is at one point the soldiers took his robe and gambled for it. It was a prized possession to have a garment of that quality. It was woven from top to bottom throughout. There was not a seam on it. It was a seamless robe. And the reason it was seamless is because that seamless robe pictured perfect righteousness. It didn't have a cut. It didn't have a flaw in it. It was the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ offers to take our tattered rags, our sinful garments, he offers to take them upon himself and in exchange to trade places with us and give us that perfect robe of righteousness which pictures his sinlessness. And so when we stand before God, we stand as if we have never sinned. Not because we didn't sin, because we've all sinned, but we stand before God in perfect righteousness because Jesus has imputed his righteousness to our account. My account was full of things that I did wrong, that I said wrong, that I thought wrong, but Jesus Christ erased all of that and gave me a clean account with God, and he paid for all of my sins with his own blood. When Jesus died, it was during Passover. And this was the time that Passover lambs were being sacrificed all over Israel. The time or the hour that this took place was 3 o'clock in the afternoon, 3 p.m. And Jesus Christ died on the cross at exactly the same time as Passover lambs were being offered all over Israel. Families were gathered together. They had a Passover lamb. They offered that Passover lamb, and that was their sacrifice. That was their sin offering. And Jesus died, God's lamb, he died at the same time that those sacrificial lambs were dying. At the same time they were slaughtered, Jesus Christ gave his life for them. So that was something that took place daily. Around Bethlehem, out in the fields, there were Levitical shepherds. These were shepherds whose job it was to have the lambs available for sacrifice on Passover. And so these shepherds had been out there in the fields. They'd been feeding these lambs. They'd been raising these lambs, not for food, not to take to the market. But these lambs were being cared for in order to be sacrificed. Every lamb had to meet a rigorous test before the priest would offer that lamb on the altar. That priest took that lamb and they examined that lamb. It was a meticulous inspection. That lamb had to be worthy of a sacrifice. And so that priest would take every lamb, and just like a doctor might give a person a physical examination, the high priest and the priest would go through every lamb that was offered, and they would check that lamb to be sure that there were no blemishes. If their lamb was blemished in any way, then that lamb could not serve as a substitute for our sins, because that lamb pictures the Lamb of God. And so it had to pass the inspection. They checked that lamb from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. They looked inside his mouth. If there was anything that was there that was not perfect, that was a sore or anything like that, then he was disqualified. But they inspected all of him. They inspected his hooves. They inspected his eyes. They even rolled his eyelids back and looked under his eyelids. And if there was a scratch, if there was a cut, if there was a wound, a scar, if there was anything, then that lamb was disqualified. And that lamb could not be the sacrifice. And so in order for that lamb to be offered as a sacrifice, that lamb had to be, in the eyes of the high priest, that lamb had to be a perfect sacrifice, because only a perfect sacrifice would do. You may remember in the early pages of the Gospels when John the Baptist was talking with two of his disciples, and Jesus walked by. And John the Baptist looked at him and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." He says, this is the Lamb that'll do the job, not these that are being offered in the tabernacle or at the temple. They're not sufficient, but this is the Lamb of God, and he takes away the sins of the world. So this virgin-born baby that came from Mary's womb, Mary's little lamb, was indeed white as snow. He was a sinless sacrifice, and therefore, I can look to Jesus as my perfect substitute. The third thing that I would say this morning is he was a sinless sacrifice, and then I look to him as my personal Savior. Why do we need a permanent sacrifice and a perfect substitute? Well, Peter tells us in this verse, chapter 3, verse 18, "For Christ died for sins once." There you see that permanent sacrifice. He died for sins once. It was permanent. Once Jesus Christ died for our sins, there's nothing else that can be done for our sins. So Jesus died for our sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous. So there you see the perfect substitute. Jesus Christ, who is righteous, traded places with us. He took our sins and he gave us his righteousness. And then it says he was put to death in the body, but made alive to the Spirit. And so he is our personal Savior. We need someone to bring us to God. Do you know why? Because on our own, we can't come to God. We can't get to God by ourselves. The word that's translated there, "bring you to God," describes someone who has the authority to introduce you to a king and give you access to him. You have to have access, and to have access, you've got to be invited. If you were invited to a black tie event, there would probably be somebody at the door checking your invitation. And if you didn't have an invitation, you would be turned away at the door. The only way you would get in is if you have been invited. Or in some cases, they may have a list, and they don't just look at the invitation, which could be counterfeited. They look at their list. And if you're on the list, then you can come in. But if you're not on the list, you're turned away. So you have to have access. And so in the same way, we've got to have moral authority. We've got to have spiritual ability to go into the presence of God. And it's Jesus Christ who makes it possible. You know, when we pray to God, we talk to God, we come before him. We don't come before God on our own merit, because our own merit is not good enough. We come on the merit of Jesus Christ. We come on the merit of what he has done for us. And so he is our ticket. He is our access to the Father. And so we come to him in the name of Jesus and based upon what he has done for us as he shed his blood for us. Somebody has to bring us to him. And the only one that can do that is a personal Savior who has earned that position by being our permanent sacrifice and our perfect substitute. That leads me to a story that I want to share with you this morning. It's probably the most incredible story that I have ever heard. And I want to just share this with you today because I think it relates to our coming to Jesus. But the story is about a man by the name of Marcel Sternberger who lived in Long Island, New York. He was originally from Hungary. He was a creature of habit. He worked downtown in New York City. And so every morning he took the 905 Long Island train from his home to Woodside, New York, where he got off that train and got on a subway. And then that subway carried him into the city for his work. And so every morning he did this. On the morning of January the 10th, 1948, he decided to go in a little later because a friend of his was sick, was in the hospital, and he wanted to visit him before he went into work that day. And so he went to visit his friend, and then he got on this 9 o'clock, this 12 o'clock train. He had never ridden the 12 o'clock train before, and so it was a little bit unfamiliar. When he got on the train at 12 o'clock, the train was packed. It was crowded, no seats available. And so he thought he was going to have to get off and wait for the next train to come. But he got on that train, and every seat was taken. And then just before the train was about to leave, one man got up out of his seat and got off the train. And so Marcel Sternberger took that man's seat. He was sitting next to a young man in his 30s, and he was holding, of all things, a Hungarian newspaper. And so Marcel Sternberger saw the paper, and he said to the man who had the paper, he spoke in his native Hungarian, and he said, "Would you mind if I read your paper?" And of course, the man hearing him speaking in perfect Hungarian was taken aback because he just didn't expect someone of his own heritage and who spoke his own language to be there beside him. And so this man was surprised to do this, and they struck up a conversation. And the man told Mr. Sternberger that his last name was Paskin, and that he was here in the States because after the war, he had been forced into a German labor battalion, or he'd been forced into a Russian labor battalion, and his job was to bury German soldiers. So when the war was over, he tried to get back home. His home was in a city called Debrecen in East Hungary. And so he finally, no transportation after the war, he walked hundreds of miles, and finally made it back to his hometown of Debrecen. When he got there, the town was in ruins practically. And so he began to look, and he went to his place where his parents lived, where he was raised, and that place had been destroyed by the war. And so then he tried to go to the apartment where he and his wife had lived. He went to his apartment, and he found strangers who were living in his apartment. And so he's walking around the city, and he's just trying to look for anything familiar, any familiar face. And he finally sees someone who looks familiar to him, and he talks to them, and he finds out that they were old friends of his family. And they told him that his family during the war had been taken to Auschwitz, which is one of the horrible German concentration camps. And they were taken to Auschwitz, and they were all dead. And Mr. Sternberger is just devastated by this news. And he just made the decision, well, I'm not going to live here in Hungary. My family is gone. And I'm not going to stay here any longer. And so I'm going to try to go to the United States. But the first thing he did was he went to Paris because he learned that there were people from Paris who were being able to find transportation and to be admitted to the United States. And so he went to Paris and finally immigrated to the United States in October of 1947. And so he's recounting this story when Mr. Sternberger, the man who had the newspaper, was sitting by him on the train. He remembered, you know, he said, a few days ago I talked to a young woman named Marja, and she said she was from Debrecen, Hungary. And so he thought about that, and he said, you know, I talked to her and heard her story, and she was so lonely all by herself in a strange city and under strange circumstances. And she said, she told me her name, and I wrote her name down. And then he said, I got her address, and I got her birthday, and I just put all of that down. And she said that she had been sent to France. She had been sent to the United States on a displaced person's boatload in 1946. And so Mr. Sternberg is so stirred by her story that he wrote down all of the details, her name, her address, her phone number on this little piece of paper. Because his intention was that later on, because she was so lonely and she was a displaced person, he was going to invite her to be able to come to some family gathering to be with some people. And so he wrote her name down, and this lady's last name was Paskin. And so he was convinced that this was more than just a strange coincidence. And so he said to this young man, he said, "Sir," he said, "I need you to trust me." And he says, "When this train makes its next stop, I need you to get off this train with me. Just trust me." And so the man was not sure about it, but he trusted him, and he got off the train with him. Mr. Sternberger went over to a payphone, and he asked his new friend to stand just a little ways off. He got that piece of paper out of his billfold where he'd written this woman's name and her phone number, and he'd call that number. And when she answered the phone, he said, "Mrs. Paskin, this is Marcel Sternberger." He said, "We met a few days ago at a Christmas party." He said, "Do you remember me?" And she said, "Why, of course. Why are you calling?" And he said, "Would you mind telling me the address that you lived at in Debrecen?" And she did. He put his hand over the phone and he said to Mr. Paskin, he said, "Sir," he said, "would you give me the address of the place where you lived in Debrecen?" And it was the same address where she lived. He said, "What's your first name?" He said, "Bella." And so then he turned with his hand over the phone and he said, "Bella, what was your husband's first name?" She said, "Bella." And so Marya then asked, "What's your wife's name?" And it was Marya. And so the man began to tremble, and he said, "Yes." He said, "How did you know?" He said, "Sir, something miraculous is about to happen to you. Take this telephone and talk to your wife." Marcel put Paskin in a taxi cab, gave the cab driver his wife's address, paid the fare, and said goodbye. And it was a miracle that a man who normally rode the 905 train took the 12 o'clock train. It was a miracle that he sat next to a man who was reading a Hungarian newspaper. And it was a miracle that 3 days later that he met a woman named Marya and had written down her name, her address, and her phone number. It was a miracle that the only man on this planet that could bring those two people together was a man who shouldn't have even been on that train. And I'm telling you today that that miracle is nothing compared to the miracle of how 2,000 years ago God sent his son, Jesus Christ, who was the only one in the universe who has ever lived or who ever will live, the only one who could take your hand and God's hand and bring you together. Jesus Christ can do that, and that's the greatest miracle of all. He did it by dying on a cross that he shouldn't even have been on. So let me tell you something, and I say this proudly, I say it unashamedly. Jesus Christ is the answer. Jesus Christ only. Jesus Christ alone is the answer. He alone is our permanent sacrifice. He alone is our perfect substitute. He alone can become our personal Savior. And he is the only one who could trade places with us and bring us to God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, today I realize that this is something that I can't do on my own. There's not one person in this building today who can do it on their own. But Lord, I surrender to you, and I pray that others today will realize that the only answer is to surrender to you, that you are the Savior. And so I surrender it all to you as my Lord. I repent of my sins. I ask you to forgive me of all of the wrong things that I've ever said, that I've ever done, and make my slate before you, my record before you, make it clean, that all sins have been erased. And Lord, I thank you that Jesus Christ was willing to trade places with me. And I thank you that he paid the price for my sins. And so I ask you now that you would help me to live for you. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a closing hymn. And if there's a decision that you would like to make today, I pray that you'll let the Lord lead you as we sing together. Let's stand.
All to Jesus.
forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sin far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him Calvary's mountain, one day they nailed him to die on a tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hands that healed nations stretched out on a tree, took the nails from me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him, rising again.
Rising again.
He loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sin far away, rising he just.
It all right out there, doesn't it? All right, before we go enjoy this delicious meal, let's sing We Are One in the Bond of Love, okay? Keith swaps the place.
We are one in the bond.